missed the Audubon Society bird watching lecture?
That would be more interesting than what we're going to.
Exactly.
We are getting a legislative update from our state representative on the bills that are going through.
At any rate, this would be the only place I could think that would, this is the only meeting room in the library, isn't it?
It is.
Maybe I came on the wrong day somehow.
You might have, because they did give us this day. I did reserve it a little while ago, so.
10 o'clock to something or other?
Well, 10:30 to 12, so.
Close enough.
Yeah, well.
I'll double check anyway.
Feel free to stick around, you know, if you're going on the Capitol.
Actually, there was one thing, thanks anyway, but maybe some other.
Awesome, well, have a good one. Enjoy the bird watching when you do find it. That's why I sent Meagan.
I've never been to.
Okay.
Let me, Hi, Meagan. Thanks for coming.
And all the flights from any observable place.
Well, I will shake your hands since you were here.
You what?
Are you sick?
No.
Okay, good. My husband's sick too, so.
No.
Well, I guess we're going to have a little bit longer, because I mean, in such a story, chatting with a couple other folks, and so. Thank you.
Well, it's been around.
I have no idea what the dates are.
Well, that seems like a fire hazard.
I guess that's true, Catherine.
Yeah, I don't know about, you know, I think we want to have a.
Okay, we can keep it over there. I don't even think about that.
So I'm hoping.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm afraid when I told people there was going to be a video, they were like, oh, now I don't have to come. I can just watch the video.
Oh, no.
Yeah, this is the first time I've done that, right?
Well, yes. And so, you know, and I sent you got my email yesterday, so I tried to give you a heads up.
I had it this morning, and I'm just going to have to kind of read off of it and get there all the stuff that you want.
Oh, I know.
Well, those were just the things that folks were saying. What I'm afraid of is I told people to watch the video, so I'm afraid that makes them think they don't have to show up. They can just watch the video.
Hey, Nydia, how are you?
Here.
Yeah, good to see you. Thanks for filming.
Which Miss Natalie Olney.
Hey, everybody down. Dear God, we approach you this beautiful morning. Thank you for this new day of life. We are so grateful that we live in a country that is free, and so please help us to keep it free, and that the laws in the enactment of the laws and the application of the laws benefit all of us. We are here because we love freedom and we love justice and the U.S. Constitution, so please help us to keep it that way. We also ask that you please help us in the war areas throughout the world that bring peace and security around the world, not just here in the United States. So we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Next, we have Wendy Harper, our Americanism Chair for the Georgia Federation of Republican Women, who will be leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
And if you don't mind, we'll be observing this flag.
Sorry, it's a bit precarious in there.
Okay, and if you don't mind?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, next on the agenda, we have new business and a DeKalb GOP update. Does anybody have any new business for our North DeKalb Republican Women meeting? Yes?
Everybody knows that the GOP is moving out of their office, and we've already moved our stuff, our little bins out of our office. And so from now on, we're going to be in different libraries or different event places. So we will no longer be meeting at the office on Lawrenceville Highway. So that's it for the GOP. Does anybody else have anything with the GOP? No? No? Okay. As far as we are you going to go over the agenda, I mean, the calendar?
Yeah, we've got event announcements at the end of the agenda.
Oh, so you'll see me again with announcements.
Well, they moved the meeting place to Tucker Recreation Center.
Right.
For next month.
Right. So next month, the Tucker Recreation Center on La Vista Road will be the meeting place. Okay, is that what you were going to say, Mike?
And is it room 16 or something like that?
I don't know the room number, but it's already secured. Everything's done for that.
Right. We'll be getting an email.
And he said we can't go in the side doors to go in the front door. We have to go in the main entrance, not the side. Yeah, okay.
All right, so that's it.
Anything else
about that? Hi, I'm Wendy Harper, the Americanism Chair. I've given you all a copy of the report that includes our meeting at the Georgia Federation of Republican Women regarding the American flag history, if you don't mind reading over that. Upcoming, we are visiting schools, asking children, preferably seniors, juniors and seniors who may be voting in the next upcoming election, to write a story, poem, anything regarding our flag and do a presentation. Betsy Kramer's daughter presented a poem which was read by Betsy Kramer at the GFRW luncheon on Redcoat Day. And so we will be asking for flag essays. If you know of any contacts or children where we could get into their programs or meet with their groups, please let me know. And we'll have information regarding the Star-Spangled Banner at the next GFRW board meeting. Thank you.
Okay, wait a minute. What's the age group?
The age group could be juniors and seniors, preferably. We're targeting young millennials who may be up-and-coming voters who would know that you can support your country, support your flag, and be proud of your country and vote for our president in the next election. So we're trying to promote Americanism and respect and pride in our country.
Okay.
Wonderful. Well, without further ado, on to the main event. We are very excited to have our House District 80 State Representative Meagan Hanson here today, who has a very busy schedule down at the Capitol and I believe is a little under the weather, but she is here with us today anyway to give a legislative update. House District 80 covers most of Brookhaven, part of Sandy Springs, and part of Chamblee. Meagan is experienced in the Republican Party. She's the former chair of the Georgia Young Republicans and has held several other offices there as well. She is a lawyer. She works in family law, and she has been very busy for us down at the Capitol. You have probably seen her name on a couple of bills, including the bill to eliminate the DeKalb CEO position.
Yay!
And several other pieces of important legislation that she is going to update us on. So thank you so much for being here.
So excuse me for having my phone. Catherine sent me a list last night of things that she wants me to make sure that I cover, so I don't want to miss any of those. That was a wonderful introduction, so I don't think that you need to know anything else about me other than that. So I appreciate that, Catherine. The first thing that we will talk about is HB 961. You may have heard a lot about this in the news. It is a very simple bill. It eliminates the DeKalb CEO position. Now, it doesn't say DeKalb, it is a general bill. But DeKalb is the only one that it currently applies to, because DeKalb is the only one of 159 counties that actually has the CEO position. DeKalb has been in the news for quite some time about various issues concerning either corruption, ethics, our water issues, our sewage issues. And it's my understanding and my research that all of this kind of links back to the CEO position and our county governance structure. This is not a new conversation in the least. This is probably the at least third bill that I can think of that has been introduced in the last couple of years to address this situation. I do believe I'm the first Republican in the House who has carried it in a while, but this shows you that it's a bipartisan issue. The last bill that was carried was actually sponsored by my predecessor from HD 80, but it was also carried by HD 81's Scott Holcomb. But that was a local bill because it did apply to just DeKalb County, and it also addressed the structure of county governance there as far as the county commission structure, in addition to the CEO position. That bill was unsuccessful because it had to go through the DeKalb County caucus, so only DeKalb County representatives could vote on it. It was unfortunate that bill was unsuccessful, but I think time and time again it has been shown that the CEO structure is not a successful governance structure for any county, but particularly this has been shown by DeKalb County. Which is why this is a general bill, because no county, it's a structure set up for failure, so therefore it shouldn't apply to any county in the future. And another reason that it is a general bill is that there are other counties who have looked at potentially using this structure. And so we need to nip that in the bud as it is, because clearly it is not successful. One of the reasons that I think it's not successful is, like I said, it's set up for failure. Too much power is concentrated in one elected position that is in charge of basically all kinds of county things that frankly should be looked at and have more of a voice by the county commission. But the CEO position is not responsible or accountable to the county commissioners. They're responsible to us. But it's hard for the citizens to try and hold that person accountable to the nth degree when they're elected every 4 years. So then it becomes, again, a popularity contest. And that's just a problem when you're trying to get things done every day at the city level, whether it be our water issues or our sewage issues. We need someone who is more of just like a full-time staff person who can make sure that these things are getting done. And if they aren't getting done, you fire them. But we don't have that right now. And so that's a lot of the issues that we're seeing. It's nothing personal to our CEO right now. I mean, again, the structure is set up for failure. I honestly, you'd have to be Superman in order to make it successful. And we haven't seen that. So Superman, woman, excuse me. But I just don't think it's possible. And I think that, again, history has proven itself to be that way. So I'm happy to answer questions about that in a little bit, but I'm gonna move on. Oh, okay. So one of the things that I know Catherine referenced was a couple of different AGC articles. Most of them are relatively benign. One of them in particular is, the Democrats are trying to use this a shiny object that is literally not even true to be a distractor from the fact that I'm actually trying to address county ethics and governance. What I'm referring to is they're trying to say that the bill was moved really fast. Okay, well, bills move really quickly when it comes crossover day, which is next week. It went straight to committee. It was heard in committee. It passed out of committee after a public hearing. I mean, that's how bills move. So, the fact that someone's saying it wasn't in the folder, we have lots of bills that aren't in the folder. It wasn't on the agenda. Well, that's why you have the line that says, that it's at the chairman's discretion. There were like two bills, I think, that were added that day, but the only one they chose to complain about is the one that is proactively addressing ethical issues in DeKalb. I mean, I have a little bit of a problem with that in and of itself. Okay. Another bill that apparently someone has asked about is House Bill 876. This was a bill that Sandy Springs, Brookhaven, and Chamblee, which are the cities that I represent, came to me and said, we do not support this bill. Basically, it changes what materials you are able to use in, for example, apartment building. This was carried by one of my friends, John Corbett. He's from South Georgia. They're very big into wood structures down there, but they also don't have the density problems that we have here in Sandy Springs. So, you know, they might, let's say, cap out at, or they might only need a three-story apartment complex. Well, here in Sandy Springs and Brookhaven and Chamblee and Doraville, and, you know, we've seen a significant amount of growth. And so, you know, maybe unfortunately, maybe fortunately, who knows, but people are building eight-story, six-story developments. And unfortunately, they're making them out of wood. And so it's our, you know, fire chief's position that this is extremely dangerous. And I actually sat through a presentation with the Sandy Springs fire chief where he showed what happens when an eight-story building that's made of wood, how quickly that burns and how quickly lives are lost. Or people are literally jumping to their death. That was not to the death, to their rescue, excuse me. That was the video that I saw. And, you know, ultimately at the very end of the day, it comes down to a local issue. I don't think that the state should be telling us what materials we can and can't build with here in our in our district, or particularly in cities at all. And so if our fire chiefs see it fit to say, listen, anything over, you know, X story needs to be made of more than wood, then that's A-okay with me because they're the professionals and I'm not gonna argue with them about fire science. But for whatever reason, people saw fit to make this a statewide legislation. I disagreed with that, so I voted no. Excuse me. Okay, I don't really see anybody. Is anybody in my district but Catherine? You are? Okay. So one of the bills that...
Mary, you're in. Your name, right?
Me? It's Gainsboro?
No.
You're 81.
Okay, well, one of the things that somebody wanted to talk about was the City of Brookhaven Public Facilities Authority. Basically, the Petrie Creek Greenway is a project that the City of Brookhaven is looking to do along Buford Highway, for lack of better terms. And one of the things, the Brookhaven City Council passed a unanimous resolution asking the legislature's authority to, or permission to, set up a public facilities authority. This authority, at least for the legislation I saw, I struck out the part about giving it eminent domain power because I thought that was a huge issue. But they would ultimately have bonding authority. Now, I have not agreed to this legislation yet. I've heard from a large number of people on the pro side. I've heard from a very small number on the anti side, literally three people. Will you make four?
Yeah, I don't want anybody to go in debt on my behalf. So,
well, and the thing that I would say to you or anybody who is supportive or not supportive is, you know, we need to be holding elected officials accountable because normally what happens is, anytime, and this is just kind of the general atmosphere of what happens at the General Assembly, whenever you have a city council pass a resolution, but particularly, well, in my case, it's, I will only accept unanimous resolutions. If it's like 4-1 or something, like, no, that is an easy out for me. But when you have a unanimous resolution asking for something, the standard practice is that the delegation honors that because it's the people who represent the people who have asked for that particular issue. And so in this case, it was a unanimous resolution. I have been holding out and trying to see if there's, you know, ways that we can work with this or not work with this. But it is an issue that I'm hearing a lot about from the Petrie Creek Greenway people. So it is something that I'm looking into very seriously. but I'm open to ideas of how to make it better. But one thing that I do think is important that maybe people aren't getting out, I'm sorry, my voice is about to be shot, is that it's not a new authority. So the people who would be on this technically new authority are actually the city council members. So that is another way to hold them accountable. Okay, moving right along. So let's talk about transportation. You may have heard in the news that there was a commission set up last session, that is a two-year commission. They are supposed to be looking at and studying regional transit and governance structure and funding. So the first year was really focused on governance structure. There are 11 entities, transit entities, that are operating in 13 different counties in the Atlanta metro region. That causes so much confusion as far as labeling, more like, you know, am I going to ride this train? Am I going to ride this? Am I going to get on this one? Where is it going? How do I know? When are they coming? How do I pay? Those entities cause a lot of confusion for people, but also it's difficult to link them up. I think it was our Senate Transportation Chairman did a study. He was trying to get from, I think it was Cherokee County, all the way over to maybe Duluth, and it took him 4.5 hours taking transit.
Four and a half hours.
And it wasn't because of, you know, just traffic. Obviously, traffic is often an issue, but it's because he had to figure out how he could, you know, use the Cobb link to get down to Marta, to get down to a bus, to get over here, to get up to Gwinnett. And so, I mean, that in and of itself is outrageous, and it's not doable for the everyday person. When you have a 9-to-5 job, there's no way in the world you can spend 4.5 hours on transit reasonably. And so we have been looking at how to come up with a regional structure, how to get all of the parties to the table. It's an issue. From Cobb County, to get Cobb County on board, but also to get Gwinnett on board. Our chairman in the House, Chairman Kevin Tanner, has been working very, very hard on that. And we actually have some teamwork, which is great, because you can't just force people to do these things. I don't believe in that either, but if you can find a good structure that everybody can agree on, I think we're in a good place. So we have been able to do that. It's obviously a work in progress. There is no silver bullet to the transportation issue, but getting everybody to the table and to have a conversation with productive goals and productive steps is very important, and we're there. And so that's wonderful. We do have a piece of legislation right now that is very, very particular and has a lot of safeguards for these people who are very concerned, like the Cobb County folks and the Gwinnett folks. And I understand everybody wants to make sure that their tax dollars are staying, you know, and, you know, benefiting their citizens. I completely understand that. But also at the same time, everybody has to be cognizant of the fact that MARTA is funded by the City of Atlanta, Fulton County, DeKalb County, and Clinton County. And at least for City of Atlanta, DeKalb, and Fulton, we've been funding it for the last 50 years. So we have to take this into account when it comes to the new people coming in and kind of linking up. While we are thrilled to have them on board, we have to be cognizant of the fact that we put in millions, billions of dollars to fund this system. So that's something that we're working on right now. Like I said, it's not an easy process. It's not an easy bill. It's a very thick bill. But we've had multiple public committee hearings available for public input, for the different counties to be involved with their input, but also the commission has had multiple studies and multiple county and all kinds of people who are bought in having that input on what we do moving forward. I think it's important that we do have community buy-in, because if you don't, you're just gonna see what we had a couple years ago with the different local T-Splosts or regional T-Splosts. And that was just basically an epic failure. So it's great that we are working on buy-in. The next step in that will be the second year of the study, which is on funding. I know that we're looking to get the state to fund or to help fund regional transit, because frankly, the entire state benefits from regional transit. One of the top things that folks like Amazon look at when they're coming here is, are my employees going to be able to get around relatively easy? That is, I mean, truly, if you don't have that, then you're not even remotely considered. So, you know, it's not only important for us to look at improving ours, but even the fact that we have one kind of puts us in that, on that top level of the radar, which is great. Okay.
Wow.
I'll tell you one of the things that I'm working on and I'm very excited about, a little more free enterprise in my opinion, is SB 17. It's the brunch bill. So years past we have, well, here, let me say this. You may not know that if you go to a restaurant on a Sunday before 12:30, you're not able to get a mimosa.
Right.
Now, the interesting part about that is that if you went to the World Congress Center, RIP, before 12:30, but maybe between 10:30 and 12:30, you could get a mimosa. So the fact that the government could sell alcoholic beverages to patrons, but then if you went across the street and you went to a private restaurant, you could not get a mimosa at the same time, to me that was a huge problem. And it's very protectionist, right? In the very least, I think that we deserve some parity or at least some opportunity for private businesses. And I'll also tell you that the state is expected to, the industry and the state are expected to bring in approximately $110 million just by adding this extra hour and a half of time. So the bill that came out of the Senate, you may have heard me before, was not exactly my ideal bill, but at the same time it's definitely progress. What happens is now is that the time's 11 o'clock, so sorry for the loss of 30 minutes, but it's 11 o'clock, and the bill requires that the local controlling authority, whether it be the county or the city, have a referendum. So people have to pass by, 50+1, that they agree to have the alcohol sales on Sunday and move back to 11 o'clock. So I'm all about this. I'm carrying it in the house. I'm very excited that we've actually made progress, because over the last couple of years, it's been the Senate that's been the holdup. And so now that we had them pass it first, thank you, Chairman Renee Unterman, then we will be able to hopefully get it through shortly after crossover day in the House. Is anybody here for charter schools? Okay, good. So we just passed an increase in funding for charter schools the other day. That's a huge step forward in moving the ball forward for charter schools. We also just passed a piece of legislation to increase basically 529, or your 529 funds from, I think, 2,000 to 4,000. So that's really awesome. On the education front. okay. So another thing I'm carrying, and I'll tell you exactly why I'm carrying it. It's not typically thought of as a Republican bill, but to me, it's a nonpartisan bill, because I think that this is just something we should be doing. I got approached last year. I don't know if y'all heard, but there were a lot of bomb threats called in to Jewish community centers, Jewish day centers, Jewish schools, and particularly a couple of them were in my district, in the Sandy Springs part of my district. So a lot of my constituents in the Anti-Defamation League reached out to me and said, hey, Georgia is one of five states that does not have any sort of criminal penalty enhancement for crimes that are committed with the intent essentially to threaten an entire community. Would you be interested in hearing this legislation? And I, after having sat through a whole forum about hearing about the atrocities that happen to people because they fit into some certain category, I said, yeah, I'd be interested in that. And so I worked with them for quite a long time trying to craft a bill that does not or eases people's fears about thought crime, because it's a penalty enhancement, it's not a new crime. You first have to be convicted of the underlying crime, and then a jury of your peers would be asked, does this beyond a reasonable doubt, did the person choose their victim beyond a reasonable doubt because they were and then you fit into the category because they were straight, because they were Christian, because they were white, because they were black, because they were Jewish. There's a whole list of categories, and it's mirrored from the federal language from 2010. This is very similar to what 45 other states have, and we had it here in Georgia, but it was struck down because it did not have those categories. So that's the underlying reason for why we have to have the categories. The Supreme Court says we have to have the categories. Otherwise, we will not be able to have a successful hate crime statute here in Georgia. Again, I understand that people have some fundamental problems with that, but you know, it is what it is. So who in here thinks that Justice Scalia was probably the most conservative justice that we've had in the Supreme Court in a really long time? Okay, so he says that this is not a violation of the U.S. Constitution. Because that's the number one thing I hear is, well, this legislation is a violation of the First Amendment. Well, Chief Justice Scalia, along with all of his colleagues, said that this is not a violation of your First Amendment rights. So I want you to keep that in mind when you're considering this, and do give it some full thought. And I would appreciate your support, but I understand if you have some issues with it, I'm happy to talk with you about them as well. Okay, so my throat is killing me, but I'll take a few questions if you have some.
According to transportation, somebody spoke at the Tisdale breakfast recently, and I would like to know if you know anything about building yet a perimeter around the perimeter.
I have not heard anything.
You haven't heard anything about that? Like, because that was that was a proposal.
So like we have in D.C. where there's like 395 and then 495.
Right, okay.
No, I haven't heard anything about
that. So that's not in any of your discussion. Okay, thank you.
Okay, getting back to the hate crime bill.
Sure.
I'm glad you're doing that because I'm a member of the Marcus Center, Jewish Center, and so, yeah, so we get those alarms. And the J is one of the largest Jewish centers in the United States, not just here in Atlanta. So thank you for that. Also, I have a question about the agriculture bill. I know the Senate bill is 418, I think.
The puppy mill bill?
The puppy bill, yeah, that went in. Mm-hmm. And so you probably know more about the House side, and I don't know.
I think they're identical, but uh-huh. I'm not sure where it is. I don't know if it's moved out of committee. I know if it comes to the floor, I'm against it.
Okay, so explain to them about the bill.
To me, it just takes away local control. I mean, again, it just comes down to a local control issue. And basically, if it's not regulated at the federal level, then it can't be regulated at the county level. And so, I mean, I think that opens up a whole wide issues of things that would no longer be able to be regulated by the county, one of which would be blue laws. So I don't really understand how this is moving, although I will tell you that the bill sponsors do not believe that this addresses puppy mill issues. That being said, you know, Sandy Springs, for example, has a provision where they don't allow Petland to sell puppy mill puppies. And so that seems to supersede that if that bill were to pass. So I'm not really sure how that's reconciled. And in my book, it's not, and so I'm currently not for that bill.
Well, I'm glad to know. I hope more of your friends down there are more online.
I'm working on it.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you familiar with the illegal alien driver's license bill that's just failed?
Yes.
This week?
Would it have failed in the Senate?
It failed this week.
In the Senate?
Okay, what? I will be honest, because we have so many pieces of legislation, I generally focus on the House legislation until at least after crossover day, or at least until they're coming before my committee, which typically is after crossover day. So I'm not familiar with that, I'm sorry.
Do you mind if I just make a comment?
Sure.
Okay, good. This week, the illegal alien license bill came up for a vote. All the Democrats are pushing for DACA. The first step is to identify these people. If they want to be on a path to citizenship, the first step is to know who they are. Unfortunately, we had three Republicans who voted with the Democrats. Two of them voted with the Democrats, and one of them walked out. Why? We don't understand. Right now, in Georgia, you can identify our teenagers by your driver's license, but they don't want to identify who's an illegal alien in our communities. I work in the construction industry. I'm a construction major, construction graduate student at Kennesaw State University, finishing my master's degree. I know a lot of these people. They've been here for 10, 20 years. I'm friends with them, but do I feel that they need to be deported? Yes. Do I like it that they're here? No. I think that they should either get registered to be a citizen, and if they're not a criminal, that's great. Contribute to our society, our taxes, you know, help all of us. But right now, we're having to pay for health care every time the Boys in Blue go out and see them, our health facilities, on and on and on. The first step would be to identify them, and when the vote came up this week, Payne voted with the Democrats. Kay Kirkpatrick voted with the Democrats. She doesn't want illegal aliens to be identified in our state. And then Watson walked out of the vote. How is that helping us? We need to go and talk to these people and ask them, why are you against this? What is wrong with the identification? Why don't you want to identify these people? Identify them, and is it a problem? We just want to know who they are. And our president's plan for immigration reform and the Democrats' request for DACA is going to start with, we need to know who they are first before they can be on a path to citizenship.
Well, since we do have our a House member here today, let's try to get a senator here, and we can definitely talk about that more. But since we do have a couple other folks, Jeff, did you have a question?
I have one. This concerns the delegation meeting. Has the delegation moved any forward on redoing the ethics board, or is Vernon still stonewalling that?
I have not heard of any progress in that regard, or the Charter Commission's either.
And another thing, bill that Billy Mitchell just kind of dropped out of the blue again. The pay raise for the commissioners and the CEO, has that been forward, or is that still?
It has been placed on my desk, and I believe it is under consideration, but it has not been heard per se. It would not be my, I would not be shocked if it did not move forward. Sorry, she had a question.
I have a question on the driver's license for the illegals. Would that be just an ID and not a driver's license, or would that be a driver's license?
Like I said earlier, I'm not sure because I haven't read that particular bill yet.
Is that legal for them to get a driver's license?
They already have driver's license in our states.
I'm not sure.
No. They already have driver's license in our states.
Can I go to another country and get a driver's license?
Yeah, if you're here.
Yeah, good point.
No, she said illegally you can get one.
Well, they were here legally for a period of time and just never go home.
Mike, did you have a question?
Isn't there a way that they can go with like a vertical,
Well, let's I want to make sure we get to as many of the issues as possible, so let's, we've got that on, it's noted for everybody.
Yeah, my question has to do with House Bill 482. I don't know its current status, but I do know it went through committee meetings. And
Mike, I'm good, but I'm not this good. What is the topic of the bill?
It's basically the opportunity to have some of the state funds as a scholarship. My wife and I chose, after a few years of experience with the school system, to take on the responsibility of raising and training our own children. We did incredibly well. They all have college degrees, went seamlessly through, and are contributing, working, taxpaying people with at least one grandchild out of the group right now. So simply as background, we paid all of our taxes. We've been homeowners, property people for many years. And yet we never received one red dime of any kind of support for all the extra money, extra expenses, extra things. Yet we accounted to the county monthly. We followed all the rules. We took all the standardized tests and reported to the county on every testing, every responsibility. Mm-hmm. They were very interested. We were incredibly successful, but we get no support, no scholarship, no nothing.
Right. So this is Wes Cantrell's bill, and I'm very supportive of it. And it is, in my understanding, I believe it's in House rules, which means that he goes and presents it, asks for it, and then the Rules Committee determines whether or not it'll come for a House floor vote. Like I said, I am supportive of it, and should it come to the House floor, I'd be yes.
Is Wendell Lord still Chair of Rules?
No, sir. He's Chair of Judiciary. He's Chair of the committee I'm on. Yes, sir. Rules Chairman is Chairman Meadows.
Nice.
Yes, from Calhoun, Georgia.
So is Frank Miller working on the homeschool funding? Since he's in charge of education.
Oh, he's senator, sorry.
Yeah, I was gonna say, it's in the House first, and then once we send it over, I would assume that it would, he would have an integral part of it.
Yeah, okay.
All right. I just wanna ask a question about what you went over with the wooden structure with the 8-story.
Easy.
Where is that standing? And that looks like if it's a safety issue, it's going to be a safety issue, that it would be in a building code.
Right, and so the bill would actually prevent it from being in a building code. It would supersede the building code.
Okay.
Which was the fundamental problem to me, because I don't think that state law should, especially when it's relatively reasonable, not be superseding a local building code. So it's passed out of the House, and so that means it's before the Senate. So if you have concerns, I would encourage you to contact your senator.
I think it's a good bill, but one more thing on the hidden furniture bill, which is Jason Spencer's bill. I wonder how you stood on that.
I've
been following it as a committee hearing.
Sure. So I'm supportive.
Right.
Yes, sir.
I think just in way of support for something you started off with. When I was in eighth grade at Chamblee High School, we were all sitting at breakfast table. When a leak of the gas water heater exploded the basement.
Wow.
And with us kids dressed ready to go to school, mom in the kitchen with us, it is unbelievable how fast your house burns down. And we lost our pet and everything in the confusion and the hurry just to get make sure we got ourselves out and call 911. Chamblee Fire were fantastic. We didn't lose everything because it was so good, so fast, so efficient. But I just cannot imagine. We lived 5 years as a young married couple in complexes in DeKalb County. How you're caught in those situations. And you, a lot of times you can't get out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you don't know either when you go into an apartment or.
Well, and that was my concern too, is that, how, especially if it's allowed, does a resident know when you go in to apply for a lease or when you're just visiting a friend, excuse me, is this structure made of fully wood? I mean, right, and so that's just a little bit troubling to me.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I will personally add that, in Brookhaven, you see this stuff going up all the time, and when you see a 5-story building going up made out of stick built, and, seeing it getting rained on, and so it does seem a little.
But McCatherine, it's going so fast, just look right around here, that if it's not, something's not done immediately, it's too late, because they're going to be grandfathered in.
Well, I do think this is a good bill, especially for the House District 80 state rep to be opposing. But so it did pass the House then?
It did, yeah.
Yeah, what number was that?
It's 876. So definitely that would be something to talk to senators about, because it does seem like South Georgia is not necessarily taking metro area considerations
right.
into concern. Mary, did you have a question?
Just a comment. With all the new apartment buildings going, I mean, they're getting more and more and closer to the area. It reminds me of my trip to Moscow, and from the airport into the city, they thought all the buildings were the same, and they were all squished together, and it's amazing to me. I don't know. Where are all these people coming from?
I don't like the growth in Atlanta at all.
Where are all these people coming from?
I don't want to. Amazon.
Well, it is a challenge, and I think that's one reason it is so good to hear from our House District 80 state rep, because Brookhaven, Sandy Springs, and Chamblee are, I mean, arguably the cities that are most impacted by this kind of thing. And, you know, zoning is really where our limited government Republican principles can sometimes come into conflict with what our neighbors want, because, you know, what works for rural Georgia when you've got, you know, 5 acres to yourself doesn't necessarily work when everybody is sharing a third of an acre lots. So I just want to say thank you so much to Meagan Hanson. So I would definitely encourage everybody, you know, speak to Representative Hanson, speak to your representatives, speak to your senators, you know, let them know what you're feeling, because it sounds like, you know, with the Peachtree Creek Greenway issue, you know, there are groups that get very organized, you know, so don't let your voice get lost in the mix on that. I see another House District 80 person in here who's arrived. So, all right, so at this point, you know, we have heard from Representative Hanson, so is there any old business or other announcements that need to be taken up for North DeKalb Republican Women?
I'd just like to announce about our meeting.
Oh, yes, we've got a meeting coming up with Chattahoochee Republican Women on Tuesday.
And it's Tuesday, and it's the Hidden Predator Bill. It's at Alpharetta City Hall. And J.D. Rowe, Jeffrey Rowe, who is a detective with Forsyth County Sheriff's Department, will present it from a law enforcement standpoint. And I heard this at the Forsyth County Women's Meeting. It's excellent. I mean, it's surprising to me, stuff I thought I knew, I didn't know. And also we'll talk about some ways, or he'll talk about ways to combat it. And so that will be this Tuesday, the 27th. We start with refreshments at 7, and then we have the meeting. The program starts at 7:30.
And is that going to be at the Alpharetta City Hall?
It's Alpharetta City Hall.
Great meeting location. Very, very nice.
And we hope all of you will come. It will be a very good meeting.
And that's Two Park Plaza in Alpharetta.
What was the topic?
Well,
Hidden Predator. It's the human trafficking. I'm sorry. J.D. Rowe will talk. He's got a presentation that is excellent, and he is deep into this. And a reporter for the AJC asked me, he said, you mean they have human trafficking in Forsyth County? And I said, oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But Atlanta leads. I think it's the leading city.
We're the number one city in the country.
Yeah, number one in human trafficking.
And number one for homelessness.
Well, so that will be good to focus on. I know we've also got a DeKalb GOP meeting that's coming up on March 8th at the Tucker Recreation Center, so keep that on your calendar. We do have a candidate here with us today who I wanted to just give a couple of minutes to address the group, since we are the North DeKalb Republican Women. We've got a candidate for DeKalb Superior Court Judge here today, Letitia Deer Jackson. So if you'd like to tell us a little bit about that.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. I will not be long. Lawyers by design talk a lot, but that will not be what you will hear today. So as I have been introduced, I am Judge Letitia Deer Jackson. I am a current candidate for DeKalb County Superior Court Division 7. It is an open seat, and I stress that because we do have some people that are running against incumbent judges. This seat was created as a vacancy for Judge Daniel Corsi, who has been on the bench for over 35 years. He has announced his retirement so that he can enjoy life after the bench with his wife and his dog. But I'm putting myself forth as a candidate. I'm a current municipal court judge. I've been a judge for over 11 years in City of Lithonia, City of Stone Mountain, where I currently sit, and I also sit in City of East Point. By virtue of being a municipal court judge, I have been allowed the pleasure and been humbled to serve as a judge by designation in both state and superior court. I'm the only candidate in the race that has sat as a judge in superior court and have judicial experience in the position that I am seeking. I also am a lawyer. I'm a civil litigator now, so I represent Great Memorial Hospital in Kaiser, doing their med mal practice, which means that if a doctor or the institution, including Emory University or Morehouse School of Medicine, is sued, I am the one of the people that represents them. I also represent MARTA, where they have catastrophic injuries or wrongful death that happened on their property. Prior to going to the firm that I'm at now, I was a family law lawyer as well as a criminal defense lawyer. I've also been a former prosecutor. So I welcome you to, I'm available to talk, but I welcome you to go to my website, Letitia for Judge, all spelled out, .com. And again, I'm Letitia Deer Jackson, running for Division 7 of DeKalb County Superior Court. Thank you.
Wow. I'll just offer in commentary on that. It is very rare when you hear a lawyer running for judge that they will actually tell you who their clients are and what kind of work they've done. So, you know, certainly North DeKalb Republican Women is not taking any official position, but that was a very impressive judicial candidate presentation, and we really appreciate your candor and transparency on that. We are only allowing candidates to speak, but I will note that Jim Beck, for insurance commissioner, has sent a representative, Dave. So if you've got any questions about Jim Beck for insurance commissioner, please speak with him. He's got some material there. And just as a reminder, you know, we do have primaries coming up on May 22nd for all the statewide offices. So make sure you educate yourself on your choices for governor, lieutenant governor, you know, everything all the way down the ballot. There will be some opportunities to do that. So please keep an eye out. And then do we have another announcement, Tally?
Yes. As you probably already know, that I'm chairman still for Caring for America, even though I'm off the board. I finally took a rest.
We'll never get her off the board. She's the heart and soul of the North DeKalb Republican Women.
So I finally said no, my initials. Anyway, for Caring for America, we have dates set up for the USO, the last Saturday in April and the last Saturday in June, and then for Ronald McDonald House, the last Saturday in August and the last Saturday in October. So we have two this summer, and then that way, even though we're not gonna have a meeting June, July, August, we will have USO for anybody that wants to sign up. We can only bring six people to the USO. We can bring many people to Ronald McDonald. So we already have, I think, four people signed up for USO. So see me if you want to volunteer. And we're asking for donations. We need some donations of water and chips and cookies for the USO and for Ronald McDonald. So, yep, that's it. Put it on your calendar if you want to come.
Pardon? How about money?
Oh, yes, we can. Oh, donate money. Yeah. Oh, Dulcie would love that. Dulcie would love that. That would help our pocketbook a lot because this year we're not having a fundraiser because we're not having the convention cycle. So, yes, anybody that wants to write a check to go to USO, write it out to North DeKalb Republican Women, give it to Tammy and earmark it USO or Ronald McDonald Funds or even Caring for America. Any of those things that you write down at the bottom will go specifically for that.
Can you give the date for the Ronald McDonald?
Yes, it's the last Saturday in August.
And October. Okay.
So whatever they are, it's like the 25th and the 27th and the whatever. So anyway, I made sure that they were all the fourth Saturday in the month so that it'd be easy for us to coordinate and to get it together. If you haven't paid your dues, please pay your dues. Andrea is the membership chair and she's collecting checks.
Yeah, and we have membership forms at the front if anybody would like to join our club today.
Yes, North DeKalb Republican Women has been around for almost 50 years. It's a venerable organization in DeKalb, and we really appreciate y'all showing up. We really appreciate Representative Hanson coming here to answer questions.
So and would like a form.
Well, with that, one more thing.
I'm going to urge you all to go. You have a webpage. A Facebook page, right?
We do. We have a Facebook page for North DeKalb Republican Women, and we post events on there.
All right, and it's under North DeKalb Republican Women.
Yes,
okay, Chad Hoochie has a web page that is we set up recently. It's under Chattahoochee Republican Women. And we have two. We have a Facebook page and then we have a private group page. I guess it's not called a page, but it's a private group. But you can go on there and we'll okay you and you can join it. And we're putting legislation, some reports, political reports from the AJC. It's getting to be interesting. So I would encourage you all to go. And if you would like a flyer, Catherine, I'm going to send you the flyer. I didn't have your email.
Well,
and then you
we'll definitely
pass it out.
We'll send it out to NDRW for sure. Well, again, thank you all so much for being here. Thank you to Nydia Tisdale for filming, and we will make the video available with Representative Hanson's answers. A lot of those questions had come to me from people who, you know, were not able to be here today, but this way we can get the information out to everyone else. And be wary of, you know, the folks who would treat this as gotcha opportunities. We should encourage our representatives to come out and speak with us frankly like this. And so again, another round of applause for Representative. All right, well, we are adjourned. Enjoy this beautiful Saturday, everyone.
Excuse me. Are you the Nydeo that was, they were hassling about the open record stuff? Yeah, I appreciate what you're doing. I'm a supporter of you. Yeah, I can't believe they're trying to do that stuff to you. Oh, okay, excellent. That's great. I think we may be back on fast. That's fine. Unfortunately, I don't. Okay, yeah, that's great. Keep up the good work. Well, there's a lot of people that are behind it. It's not saying anything. You bet.
All right. Is anyone else going to get in the picture? Okay, very well.
Thank you.
We're good. All right. One, two, three, gotcha. All right, one more time. Sorry. One, two, three, that's lovely. Thank you, and we're gonna do one more.
Thank you, you all.
Okay, here we go. One, two, three, and I'm gonna try it with a flash just for kicks, see if that goes. Okay. All right, one, two, and three.